In their own quiet way, the Germans drink more beer than any other nation. And in Germany, no state drinks as much beer as Bavaria. The Bavarians achieve this by drinking to schedule. They have one type of beer for the morning, another for the afternoon. One type of beer for winter, another for spring, and yet another for summer. There's always a new season to celebrate. A beer for every season, and an occasion for every beer. I have a formal invitation for such an occasion. It's a quiet coat and tie function in the upstairs room of a Munich tavern with a few of the regulars. Well, the Munich Tavern, the Hofbräuhaus, with a few hundred of the regulars. These people are the elite of Munich and Bavaria. Businessmen, civil servants, artists, writers and politicians, all here to celebrate the ceremonial tapping of the first barrel of a very special seasonal brew. The mallet is in the hands of the Minister for Finance of the Free State of Bavaria. A true economic whet. It's hard to imagine Britain's Chancellor of the Exchequer doing this, but in Bavaria, beer is a matter of state importance. In fact, the state owns the Hofbräuhaus. In Bavaria, they say the year has five seasons. The fifth season has its official start here, at the beginning of May, with the appearance of this rich, dark, powerful brew.
They call this seasonal springtime beer the May Bock beer. Bock means goat in German. And this beer really has got a kick. It's got more than 7% alcohol by volume. And it's so chewy and toffee-ish that I'm never really sure whether you're meant to drink it or eat it. In fact, the Bavarians call it liquid bread. So I think I'll have a slice.
Bavarians are never casual about their beer, with good reason. West Germany as a whole has about 1,200 breweries, more than a third of the world total. And 800 of these are in one state, Bavaria. Bavaria is famous for its lager beers, but it makes at least half a dozen distinct variations on that theme, and at least as many other styles that aren't lagers at all. Munich, the capital, has six big breweries. Sometimes they seem to be on every street corner. Brewing in this area dates from the beginning of the millennium. The earliest brewers here were monks, the Franciscans, the Augustines, and the Fathers of St. Paul. The Augustiner beers are especially well regarded by the locals. Löwenbräu is the best known to the rest of the world. Each brewery produces 10 to 15 classic styles of beer, but one feature they have in common is that they're all made according to the Bavarian Beer Purity Law, probably the oldest consumer protection law in the world. It's a purity that you can really taste in the malty Maybock. Seasonal Bock beers are produced all over Germany, but the first was made at the Hofbräuhaus. The name Hofbräuhaus means Royal Court Brewhouse, and this stately saloon was established by Duke Wilhelm V of Bavaria in 1589. In those days, no self-respecting royal would have been without his own brewhouse, any more than he would have built a palace without a kitchen. Even without the royals, there's still a social ritual to the Hofbräuhaus. A touch of upstairs and downstairs. In Munich, you've made it if you've been invited upstairs for a drink with the minister. Downstairs, the proletariat raise a cheer in the most famous public bar in the world. I was lured downstairs by the sound of the hunting horn. I thought it might be announcing a beer hunt, but it just turned out to be a post-horn gallop. The locals put a lot of energy into looking like Bavarians in a beer hall, and the appreciative tourists soon get into the swing. The mighty Bock haven't found its way downstairs yet. I thought I'd better get out before it did. Since Bavaria became a republic, the royal family no longer have their tavern in the town, but they do boast a stylish spot in the country. Just outside Munich, at the castle of Kaltenberg, Prince Leutpold of Bavaria continues the family's brewing tradition and champions his forefather's purity law.
The first official records. So in 2 years' time or three, we will have our 700 years anniversary here.
Right across Europe, kings and dukes and princes used to run breweries and run the brewing business. Why has that survived, especially in Bavaria, where it hasn't survived elsewhere?
Well, in Bavaria, we, as a family, were heavy beer drinkers over centuries. And we think that beer is the most important part of our food. We regard beer not as an alcoholic beverage. We think it's the most important part of our daily food intake, and that's why we kept in brewing.
Which of your ancestors set out the German beer purity law, the Reinheitsgebot?
That was Duke Wilhelm IV in 1516. We had some purity laws for different parts of Bavaria earlier, but the one which came, the most famous one, was the one of 1516, because that one later became extended over all of Germany, and it is still in function today for the German brewers. And Bavaria later has made it one of the few questions when it entered the German Empire that the Reinheitsgebot had to be spread out for the rest of Germany. The right for the purity law, it was very important because people were poisoned before, and we try to keep beer solid and clean because it's one of our main food products.
What does solid and clean pure beer mean to you? What's pure beer?
Well, pure beer is, first of all, beer made out of hops, malt and water. No other ingredients besides yeast, which grows in the beer. And it means no chemistry, no chemical additives, and no other raw materials such as sugar or potatoes or God knows what other people are sometimes using.
Prince Leutpold has his own way of ensuring that he enjoys pure beer. He brews it himself. His castle is a home and a brewery, and his cellars tell their own story about the history of Bavarian beer.
And those lagering cellars that you had at that time, of course, you still got them.
Yes, sure. And they were done very deep and were cooled with natural ice.
So they're right below where we're standing at the moment,
yes,
the cellars?
Yes, two floors under.
So your whole home and your brewery is standing on top of the
yes,
the lagering cellars?
It's all filled
cellars
with beer. Almost like a beer swimming pool.
This cellar at Kaltenberg is two stories below the castle. And it was in cellars like this that lager beer brewing was developed. Lager is in fact the German word for store. And the beer in this barrel is being stored. It's being lagered. The original reason for storing the beer in these barrels was that it was impossible to brew in summer. The wild yeasts of the summer got together with the brewer's yeast and played havoc with the beer. So what brewers did was to make a huge batch in March and set it aside for use during the summer. Here in Bavaria, the brewers had cold cellars, often caves in the Alps. And one thing they noticed was that not only did the beer stay in good condition in these caves, it actually improved. What was happening was that the yeast in the vessels was sinking to the bottom, out of harm's way. And the result of that was a beer that was especially clean and especially round, the kind of beer that we've come to know as lager beer. Although the Prince keeps his old wooden lagering vessels in reserve, he has steeled himself to more modern equipment. Behind the stainless shine, the cold lagering method is just the same. While the beer matures at a chilling 2 degrees Celsius, it gains the clean, rounded taste that characterizes a true lager. The term lager has got everything to do with the behavior of the yeast and that long, cold period of maturation, and nothing at all to do with the color. The first lagers were dark brown, and Kaltenberg still regards its dark brown lager as its house specialty. It's a spicy, coffee-tasting lager. Most Bavarian breweries will make a dark lager. They'll call it a Dunkel, that's the German word for dark. And they'll also make a pale lager, which they'll call a Helles, that's the German word for pale. And they'll probably make a festival lager, which will be a little fuller in colour and a little stronger. They probably have a Bock beer as well, which will be extra strong. And they'll have a range of wheat beers, perhaps one that's pale, one that's dark, and one that's sedimented with yeast. Wheat beers are an even older style than lagers, and a few years ago, they seemed to be vanishing from the market. Then suddenly they became fashionable again, and in the last 10 years, wheat beers have achieved 20% of the Bavarian market.
The crisp, refreshing wheat beers in their vase-shaped glass, and sometimes with a garnish of lemon, signify summer as much as a heartier Maybock heralds spring. There's a place for every beer, and every beer in its place. Bavaria can seem feudal and God-fearing. It's a corner of Europe deeply rooted in country life and devout Roman Catholic ritual. Every village has its onion-domed church and a beer garden, and the one is usually convenient for the other. Every community has its own brewery, but most of the beers rarely venture beyond their own village. To enjoy them, you have to seek them out in the valleys, the forests, and the country towns. Bavaria is a fairy tale place for the beer hunter, and nowhere are the hunting grounds happier than in the northern part of Bavaria, the region known as Franconia. There's nowhere in the world with more breweries per square mile than Franconia, and there's no city in which to drink beer that's more lovely than the little Baroque town of Bamberg. It's a town of only 75,000 people, but it has 10 breweries, and every one makes beer with its own individualistic character. A town of 75,000 people with more breweries than Munich, London, or Milwaukee. Thank you. Almost every Franconian beer is noteworthy, and some are positively pyrotechnic. Nowhere is beer more elemental. Outside two or three very special breweries in Franconia, you'll find huge wood piles like this. What they do with this beech wood is to burn it in their malt kilns, and the malt they produce in that way makes for a brew that's the beer world's answer to single malt scotch. If this were a Scotch whisky maltings, they'd be burning peat. Instead, it's a beechwood fire that dries the malt, and its smoke pervades the grain in the kiln. When this smoky malt goes into the brew, it'll add its distinct flavour to the beer. The end result is a Rauch beer, a smoked lager. It's a classic local style in the Bamberg area, and the Schlenkerle brewery tap is the most celebrated place in which to drink it. This room used to be part of a monastery. Now it's part of a pub. It dates from the 12th century, and the Bamberg brewing tradition is at least as old as that. This very traditional Bamberg beer has a real depth of character. The beechwood gives it a tremendous smokiness and intensity. Some people, when they first taste it, are really shocked. In fact, the locals say you need to have 6 or 7 liters before you really get to like it. I think that's a canny country way of encouraging you to drink the stuff. I loved it the first time I ever tried it. It's the perfect accompaniment to Bavarian ham, a smoked Bavarian beer with a smoked Bavarian ham. But there's more than one way to fire up your beer. The Rauchenfeld Steinbier Brewery in nearby Coburg has revived a long-lost technique involving rocks. The purity law has nothing to say on the subject of putting rocks into your beer, so long as you take them out before you bottle it. These rocks, going into a lagering tank, are covered with a smoky caramel coating. It's not an additive, and these are not any old rocks. This is the final stage of one of the world's oddest brewing procedures. Once again, it all begins with a beechwood fire, this time to heat rocks cut from the brewery's own quarry. After 12 hours, the rocks have reached 2,500 degrees Celsius and are ready to be plunged directly into the brew kettle. Hoisting the white-hot stones to the kettle is an arm's-length arrangement. In the days of wooden vessels, this was one way to boil the brew. Here, the brew is nearly up to temperature. The rocks provide the final push and an instant sauna for anyone in the vicinity. When the hot rocks hit the brew, the natural sugars of the malt fuse onto the rocks, forming a dark caramel coating. Later, after they've cooled, these are the rocks that go into the lagering tank. There, the sugars will ferment, giving their own treacle toffee flavour to the beer. They call it stone beer, in German, Stein beer. Franconia already has Stein wine, so why not Stein beer? These fiery Franconian brews are not for timid souls. The Rauch beer is intensely smoky. The Stein beer is burnt and caramelized. Cynics say it's an elaborate way to make beer, but I think it's worthwhile to produce a beer as seductive as this. It's as warming as a log fire, as inviting as a cozy hearth. The perfect bedtime beer. 5 years ago, this brewery was near the point of closure until they resurrected the rocky method of production. Unlike most Bavarian breweries, the Rauchenfels brewery no longer lives on everyday beer for the traditional local market. This distinctive stone beer is marketed in equally distinctive swing top bottles as a specialty beer for national and international sale to consumers as far away as Britain and the United States. All over Bavaria, small breweries face the same dilemma, wondering whether they can stay rooted in village life as new generations face a Europe that's one big market. A typical example is the Hofmark Brewery in a village in the Bavarian forest. Hofmark has become an enthusiastic exporter, but is still keenly aware of its village roots. Each spring, it presents its own Maybock to the local people. Its four-day May festival, held inside the brewery itself, is a family occasion for brewers and customers alike. Like 90% of Bavaria's 800 breweries, Hofmark is family-owned. At a festival like this, the owners make sure to share a drink with the families who come to buy their beer. In the 4 days of the festival, they will probably have a chat with every one of their regular customers. Paul and Maria Hearing and their children work as a family in the brewery. Their home is right next door. Being a brewing family is a way of life in Bavaria.
Yes, I prefer beer because I grew up with beer and I like it more. I like the taste better than wine.
You have to learn to be a brewer's wife because after all the children, it's a private life and the business life. It goes, it is so mixed because we are very near living to the brewery.
Their Maybock is pale in colour, firm-bodied and smooth. Between the bucolic entertainment, 5,000 litres will be cheerfully consumed by the locals and the odd beer hunter. For the rest of the year, the brewery makes a pale mild lager, a pale bitter lager, and a range of wheat beers. Its specialty is the bitter lager. This one is clarified over beechwood. It's an old technique of the region, rarely used today, but proudly practiced by Budweiser in the United States. The traditions and techniques of Hofmark are already receiving keen attention from Paul Hearing Jr. For 240 years, every male in this family has been expected to take up brewing. Only one declined. He became a doctor and had to change his name. But that was 150 years ago.
How would you feel if your son, Paul, told you that he didn't want to be a brewer? He wanted to be something else.
Oh, Mr. Jackson. Ich glaube, das ist unvorstellbar. Das, da haben wir noch nie Gedanken gemacht.
Beer may be thicker than blood, but that alone will not guarantee survival for the family brewers of Bavaria. Hofmark recognizes the growing competition in Europe and has chosen to fight by expanding its business. They're selling their beer in several other European countries and have even looked at the American market. It's a bold approach, but can it work?
Oh, ich denke, wir haben durchaus Chancen. Wir haben jetzt seit 240 Jahren bewiesen, in Bezug des 30-jährigen Krieges, zwei Weltkriege, Revolutionen davor, Schwedenüberfälle, ich weiß nicht, was noch alles über unser Land kam. Und die Brauerei steht immer noch. Und wie Sie sehen, wir haben mit Erfolg expandiert. Und ich denke, dass wir auch das Gebilde der EG noch überstehen können. Ich für meine Generation auf jeden Fall und hoffe, dass noch so viel Substanz da ist, auch für meinen Sohn, das weiterzuführen.
Beide Hackler fertig, zieh an!
The depth of rural tradition has been perhaps the most powerful defense mechanism for the Bavarian brewers. Bavaria still has its seasonal beers. It still has its classic local styles of beer. And it still has its purity law. But does pure beer have a place in modern Europe? It's expensive to produce beers the old-fashioned way, and Europe's biggest brewers don't. Furthermore, beer made the pure way tastes like... well, it tastes like beer, which is an alien concept to many consumers elsewhere.
The Germans say that they'll stick to brewing according to their purity law, come what may. But the European courts have said that foreign breweries needn't observe the law if they wish to sell their beer in Germany. So, will the German consumer continue to prefer traditional German beer, or will a younger generation be tempted by the newer names of glamorous foreign brews? Thus far, it seems that the Germans are going to be loyal to their liquid bread rather than some international sliced bread. And I'll drink to that.
Thank you.